Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Future Friday. In today's episode, we're going to take a look at battery bank of the future or grid scale power storage. So before we dive into it, we have to understand why there is a need for such a thing. So first is safety and stability. You do not want to live in a world where your hospital can lose power, your airports can lose power, or things of that nature. They can have short-term backup, but they cannot have power generators running them 24/7. So you, for safety and stability reason, you want to make sure your grid is up all the time. Grid is very difficult sort of situation, where grid is the largest machine we ever put on this planet. Largest, like there is no other machine that can come even close to this. So, and if grid goes down, like any damages happen to the grid, suffice to say, you can cripple a nation just by crippling its grid. So grid stabilization is crucial, because grid has no inherent capacity to it. It cannot be undersupplied, it cannot be oversupplied. You will damage the grid. Then nowadays, why there is so much talk and this is coming to public attention, is because we have renewable energy, which are classified as intermediary source. Basically, they will not give you 24/7 power supply. So for that reason, you need a way to store that energy to either provide at night or provide at the time of peak demands. But there are two types of demand. So first demand we come to is grid stabilization. Now you have to understand, grid are nationalized and basically interlinked. What does that mean? Think of this way, like India could have 20, 30 nuclear power plants. It could have 100 to 300 dams. It could have 1000 to 2000 coal fired power plants. Now they can all supply power to their local districts, but it's going to be very tedious to do it this way. So what we do is link all of them into a grid, and then grid gives power out to homes or businesses. Basically, this way, if one power plant goes down, other power plant can increase their production and compensate for it. Now this way we get, this is a two-edged sword. Basically, all the benefit that you will get from grid interlink also backfires on you. Basically, like if there is not enough safety in the system, let's say for some reason a power spike goes from one power plant to another power plant, it can cripple the whole chain. For that reason, grid stabilization is crucial. Second, because grid itself is just a collection of wire, it inherently does not have storage capacity. So you cannot have a scenario where you are oversupplying, nor you can have a scenario where you are undersupplying. It must be perfectly balanced, as all in things in the universe should be. So in that sort of scenario, when you go where power plants are generally 100% efficient when they are running at full capacity. This is because whenever engineer is like, I'm going to build a coal fired power plant, they want to make sure they make their money as quickly as possible. So they will design the system to run at 100% and 100% efficiency. For the simply to understand this, think of it this way. You are getting 100 megawatts. You're like, okay, there's not enough lead. I'm going to throttle down my system to make 50 megawatts. Here's the deal. You will be burning relatively more coal to get that. This is why we have engines that are of different scales. You do not get efficiency if you throttle down something that is meant to provide hundreds of megawatts and producing only few megawatts. For this reason, they have to sell electricity at peak performance, as in 100%. So for in this example, let's assume they are giving 1500 megawatts of power 24/7. That's their base load. That's like they can handle that power load 24/7 into 365 without any worry. So that's awesome. Okay, they got the power. Now demand fluctuates a lot. So in this graph that I'm showing you, now at zero midnight, basically there is no need for, ACs have been already cooled down, so there is no need for it. And people have calmed down, so a lot of off electronics, and there's not enough power demand in the grid. However, you are still producing. So what do? You take this amount of power that is overproducing, you send it into your storage. Now you keep it, you just store that power. Now when the demand goes high, as in when grid demands more power, then what rate applies is called peak demand rates. Basically, let's say you are selling the electricity to the grid, let's say $10 per megawatt. At that time, they will be like $50 per megawatt. Yes, it does go that high, not necessarily in that ratio, but the prices go high as soon as grid exceed the baseline capacity. That's why they were always mention it as in like my baseline capacity versus my peak capacity. So the baseline capacity, actually at that time, if you sell even a small amount of electricity, you'll make more money out of it. So because you have already stored the power at the time when nobody was using it, you sell it at triple the rate. triple rate is generally average for this. So you make double the money. All the money you have invested into making that grid storage system, you will pay off in like first 2-3 years, and after that is just raw profit. So that's why they always want to make sure like power plants like this have some way of storing energy. How, I will show you later. Then that was one type of demand. Second, we have second type of demand, which is called intermediary power source, basically solar and wind. Now, solar power is the best source of renewable energy as of now, that is reaching price parity, as in like it will be cheaper to produce power based on solar rather than coal. It's almost there, it's almost reached. Wind is way far off. Nuclear, while it is very good, but like there is a lot of stigma attached to it and danger attached to it. So as of now, as I speak to you, solar is the closest, as in like per dollar per kilowatt, it's like it's almost there. Almost there. In some countries already exceeded, like Germany specifically. But it has no baseline capacity. Like you cannot plug in your solar farm to your grid and say like, okay, my baseline capacity is 600 megawatts. You know for a fact that someday there will be cloud coverage, you might be producing only 300 watts, or heck, that might be heavy raining and you might not be producing electricity for a few days. So there is no base load capacity. For this reason, nobody likes solar. Like this is the biggest hurdle with it. So, and there is no night power. So let's say you are a small town, you're a small city. What do you do at night? Let's say you don't have big loads, let's say all heavy equipments you run in sunlight, and at night everything calms down, everything is low power requirement, but there is no power. You still want to make sure your fan runs at night, you know, or air condition or whatever have you. So for this reasons, it has a different need to what the power plant needs compared to, like, you know, they are doing it to make maximize profit and stabilize the grid. They have to do it. Without it, they cannot be mass adopted. For this reason, battery banks makes a lot more sense. Now, so I showed you two demands. Now let me show you tools to solve it. First, lithium ion battery we have. It's almost ready to go, as in like you can go and buy. And it has Elon Musk. So wherever there is Elon Musk, everybody already assumes that thing is ready. Like, you know, boom. He's supposed to put almost a gigawatt of battery output by end of 2018. Let's see whether that happens or not. The biggest problem with Elon Musk is like his mouth. Like, he's a good man, he gets his shit done, but his timelines are a joke at this point. Like, literally, flat out, timelines are a joke. You should not give timeline when you cannot commit to it. Now, this lithium ion battery packs, we know the technology. Technology is almost matured, as much as gonna mature. Like, we cannot push lithium ion any further. Basically, we might create a lithium ion batteries that are like 2 to 30% more capacity, but we can change its ability to charge and discharge. We are working on that. Like, we can have batteries in the future which can charge in a few minutes. So that's the most hopeful we can expect. But it is mature technology at this point. The load leveling that it does, as in like, you know, under demand, under providing and over providing, it can handle weekly, daily and hourly. Now, load leveling is very crucial for any grid. Now, how grid handles under production, like, you know, basically they are producing very little but demand is high, they have power plants that are dedicated for this sort of thing. Nobody wants to run them because per kilowatt they charge more, like, as in like their running cost is much higher. But if you exceed the baseline, government has to pay that peak price demand. So that peak price demand, the only way to handle it is basically either you have a battery or an emergency generator storage. Now, generator storage like that are coal fired or petrol based, they are very expensive, like very, very expensive. They make coal fired power plant look cheap. So for that reason, nobody wants to handle it. But for load balancing, lithium ion batteries can only handle weekly, daily and hourly spikes that happens. Now, all these things have to happen almost instantaneously. So if you hear somebody saying like, we're gonna use flywheels, we will use flywheels for intermediary. Basically, like whenever somebody turns on a drill, flywheel will dump the energy. Whenever somebody using supercapacitors, flywheel will dump the energy. Or supercapacitor itself can be used in this sort of scenario. But it will handle the power fluctuation that happens on an hourly basis. Like, you know, somebody turning on a drill, somebody like turning on a very powerful microwave, or, you know, things that happen inside an hour. If you have something that is like, you know, megawatts of power going out, then you will switch to this. You have like, you know, daily power up downs, like, you know, solar overproducing in day, you store the power in this, and at night you drain it slowly. Awesome. Now, be mindful, the battery pack lose their power over time. Now, this rate is very random. because they are affected by way too many elements, like temperature of the environment, the temperature of the cell, health of the cell. There are way too many elements to it, but you could lose your power. Like, let's say you charged megawatts of power into this, like you put 10 megawatt power into this and you're like, okay, I forgot I put 10 megawatts. Let's say 5 months from now, you can't go there and get 10 megawatt. At best, you will get roughly 6. So as long, that's why I'm specifying, they can only handle up weekly. Otherwise, just by self-discharge, they will lose a lot of power. Now, this is getting better. This is getting better. But if you are doing daily, it's a very good. But weekly is pushing it. So you can't exceed this timeline. This is first technology. Second technology, we have flow battery. Now, the biggest side effect of flow battery, it still needs a bit more R&D and it has no Elon Musk. So even though this technology might be better for the grid scale, it does not have Elon Musk. So everybody is ignoring this. Now, why I say this is better is simply because it has no power loss or degradation. Basically, you bought 1 megawatt lithium ion battery pack, over time it's gonna lose the capacity. It can come down to, let's say, 0.8 megawatt. 0.6 megawatt, over time it will lose its capacity and you cannot discharge it to 0%. However, this you can charge from 0% to 100% and discharge same way, 100 to 0. There is no inherent capacity loss with this. And it has moving parts, so there is a lot of moving things into this, specifically pumps. And but inherently, how the chemistry is working on this, it will not fail on its own. Like, of course, things will deteriorate. Those sort of thing happen, but inherently there is no cycle limitation as you have with lithium ion cells. The cells you have in your power wall or electric car, those cells have limitations, as in they can only charge and discharge roughly 3000 cycles or 10,000 at max. This puppy has no such thing. This is like capacitor, it can keep going on. And I have linked a video in the description where you can watch these things. Now, this is not ready for prime time. Neither is that lithium power wall thing. So this still needs a bit more R&D to make it mass production, start mass production of it. However, this can store power for months or 2 years or to decades. Like, they have tested it for like months and it stores the same amount of power. So you can have, like, let's say in winter, your country almost power supply of your winter power demand of your country goes to zero in winter. You can just store it on this and spend it in summer. It can store power for that long. Inherently, it can store power for a very, very long time. For that reason, I think for grid scale, especially, you know, when you have large amount of solar up and down, this serves a better function than lithium ion. Now, I told you, like, coal fire power plants have a way to store energy. How do they do it? Welcome pumped storage hydroelectricity. This is the biggest, the most baddest, the largest capacity we ever have. Basically, its side effect, it has very low efficiency. Basically, you only get 70% out. So you put 100 megawatt, you will only get 70 megawatt out. And it is very restrictive. Basically, you have to find a geographical place where there is an easy height gradient, as in, like, you have at least 100 meters of height apart, and it has water availability. Obviously, it's hydro. But it's tested. We've been doing this for 75 years, more than that, and it is super large scale. Link in the description below. And in the description video, I am showing you something that is 2000 megawatt. Just imagine how much you have to spend to get that power in Tesla walls. It's just, there is no competition to this. This is the biggest, the oldest, the most tested system that we have. Only consequence of this that A, it's very low efficient. Some people are saying that they can get as high as 85%. Because when these were designed, they were kind of old technology. Nobody was taking them very seriously. They were just like, you know, I will say, you know, maximize our profit. Nowadays, this can also store wind power, store solar power, whatever power source you have, you can just store in this. And the idea of it is very simple. You have a reservoir and you have a reservoir. There is a height gradient. There is a gravity potential. So you charge it by, you know, discharging the from bottom and putting the water in top. And then when you need the power, you just undo it. There's a video in dictionary. It's a very simple. It's basically you are creating your own dam, basically. That's all it is. That's why I'm showing you this image. Like, dam has natural water. Here you are artificially pushing the water up. This is how you are charging it. How you're discharging it, you're simply letting the water go through the turbine. So this, as I speak to you, the largest capacity of power storage is available to them. Like, I'm talking gigawatts, as you can already show. That's one plant itself can have upwards of 2 gigawatt of storage, and others overall, grand total, we have roughly 100 gigawatts of storage in this. It's not like it's gonna keep running for decades. It has only capacity for like half day to 2 days. So the capacity is designed by the engineer based on the needs. So this, as I speak to you, is the best friend to all the renewable energy that we have now. Like, because of the nationalized grid, like, India have this luxury. In the one corner of India, in Rajasthan, where is very high solar flux, it's the desert, you can get the solar power. But to store that power, because it's nationalized grid, the grid can absorb that power on the other end, where we are closer to Himalayas, but we have high gradient and we have water there. So using that, we can absorb the peak demands and handle it very effectively. I would suggest all of you, before you go into, oh, lithium is the future, lithium is, they can only handle upwards of 10 to 500 megawatts, 2000 megawatts. Like, there is no comparison for this. This is the best solution we have as of now for handling very, very large scale. Now, I am a bit hopeful about flow cell batteries, because inherently what they use is very cheap. Everything in the system is inherently cheap. So once they reduce, once they hit what's called large scale production, I'm hopeful they might be able to reduce the price. So, but will they be able to compete with this? Maybe, maybe not. So this was my presentation on grid scale power storage. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please like. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it. And leave a comment what we want to see in the next episode of Future Friday. And please subscribe. Press the bell icon as I make video every day. And as always, thanks for watching.